What an awesome morning. Oh, we got the wrong one. Awesome. How many of you guys are glad to be in the house of the Lord this morning? I just woke up and I had that scripture on my mind that it just said, what does it say? Now it just left me. It is good.
That must have been good.
It just good left scripture. Me. What does it say?
That is the most powerful
you
word you've shared all day.
You can edit this out of the video, awesome. All right? That does not go online. It is good to be in the house of the Lord. I don't even know. Look it up. You tell me what it is later, all right? I totally forgot. I was thinking about this old song that I grew up in church, and it said, we enter the gates with thanksgiving and into his courts with praise. And you know what? Although that song, I sang it 20 years ago, it's true. When we walk through those doors, man, we are so glad to be here. And we are so glad that you took the time to come out to be in the house of God with us this morning. We know you're going to have a great time. You're going to benefit from being here in God's presence and with God's people. Well, this morning, just really quick, I want to tell you that this Wednesday night, we are going to start our new series in life groups. Everybody say life group.
Life groups.
How many of you guys want to do life alone?
Oh, she about tricked some of you.
I did. Well, you don't like to raise your hand anyway,
that's mean.
So I thought I would do it the opposite. Nobody wants to do life alone, do they? Life groups is an opportunity for you to come out, join a group for 6 weeks, and honestly, connect with people who maybe have gone through something that you're going through. Maybe you're not going through anything, and you can encourage someone else. We've got sign-up sheets out in the foyer, but let me tell you this, okay? We are going to start shutting down life groups because we're going to try to keep them balanced in the numbers, all right? So what does that mean to you? This is what it means. If you're not on that sign-up sheet, after today, then you won't really get to pick what group you go to when you show up. It'll be whichever group has open seats, okay? Because here's the thing. Our life group pastors, our life group leaders, their job is to connect with every single one of you in their group. When somebody has 30 people, it's way too many to connect with. That is a small church, is it not, Brad? We started.
We'd have been
so happy to have 30 people show up on a Sunday morning
like,
in the
yes!
beginning. Yes!
Awesome!
We have
it's
a church,
out of control.
Right?
Totally out of control.
He's not people. Kidding. If you were here in the beginning, man, 30 was awesome.
It's awesome.
So, if you're not signed up, before you leave, go to the connecting point. There's five different groups. We're adding one more this go-around because we are growing. So, make sure you get signed up for life groups.
Right. Can you guys believe Halloween is tomorrow?
But the weather feels like it's August.
And it feels like it's August.
Yeah.
Yeah, this
is
insane how fast
it's awesome.
This season has flown. So every year we've been doing this, I don't know, 3, 4, 5 years, something like that. Cornerstone Church in Grove has been putting on this Halloween outreach for like 50 years or since Moses was doing his thing. And it's awesome. Like thousands of kids come out with their parents and there's tons of little carnival games stationed throughout the whole Civic Center. There in Grove, and then like every 30 minutes, they do these breakout sessions where the kids do dances and routines, and they just kind of do these presentations, and they're sharing the gospel all night. So, you know, part of our vision as a church is God showed us this in the very beginning, that when he looks down, he doesn't see church signs, he sees his children. And so we've taken it upon ourselves as the vision that God has given us to link up as often as we can with other area churches, because it's God's heart. He wants all churches to prosper and to grow because his heart is to win the lost, whatever the cost. So we've been doing this for years now. If you want to join in, it's a lot of fun. If you don't have kids at home, this is perfect for you. Just come and join us. You're going to just be running a very simple carnival game of some sort, distributing candy to kids all night, and it's just a great, great time. So if you want to do that, make sure we have a sign-up sheet at the connecting point, so make sure and go sign up for that, and it'll be a lot of fun. Okay, so today we're concluding part 4 of this series, Struggles. I hope that this has been a blessing to you. If it has, will you do us a favor? Will you go to our YouTube channel and share it on your social media feeds and let people know what's been happening here? Because I'm telling you, God's word is powerful and it's life-changing. And we want to bring encouragement to as many people as we can possibly reach. Some people are just bound and determined. They are not going to step foot in church, maybe because they've been hurt, maybe because just whatever. The enemy's just really, really working on them to keep them out of God's house. But if you'll share that on social media, we can get the word of God to them and encourage them. How many of you guys know, we know people each and every day that are surrounded by struggles, right? And they need the encouragement of this word, so we can reach them that way. If you would you stand up with me? Let's get the circulation going. Let's stretch our legs. And I want to, the reason we stand up sometimes when we pray is because we want to give God our undivided attention and ask him to speak directly to our hearts. Isn't that crazy that God loves you so much? He wants to speak to your heart. He wants to speak into your life today through his written word. He loves you and he has something for you, but we have to receive it. We have to be prepared to receive what God would have to say to us. So let's pray that right now. Father, in Jesus' name, we know your word is powerful. We know that it's life-changing. God, we ask right now that you would speak to our hearts. God, we've come expecting. We're going to leave inspired by your word. Help us to leave this place different than the way we came, ready to love you and love people. We thank you in advance, God, for the great things that are to come. In Jesus' name, everybody said, amen, amen. Amen. You may be seated this morning.
Well, in this series, Struggles, in part 1, 2, and 3, we've been in the book of James, which is a book that only has 5 chapters, but is so very powerful. Like, I have read the book of James over and over in my life. And if you've ever wondered, like, does God just speak directly to me? Just open James, all right? If you got a problem with your faith, if you've got a sin problem, an addiction problem, a mouth problem, we're going to chat about that today. Whatever your problems are, you can go to the book of James, and he speaks about it in only 5 chapters. Well, in the first part of this series, we talked about how as we go through our struggles, James tells us we are to consider it all joy, which just seems ludicrous. Why would I be excited that I would have struggles, right? And if you know one of my sons, this entire series, he keeps walking up to people and just saying, struggle's real, huh? When they're struggling, I mean, our car breaks down and he goes, struggle's real, Mom. Gotta live it. I'm like, I'm gonna knock. No, I didn't. I just smiled. I said, you're right. Struggle's real, man. Struggle's real. It is. And you know, we don't get excited and happy over having challenges and trials and struggles, but we can take joy in knowing God is still in control. He's still on the throne, no matter what you're going through. Last week, we talked about the inward struggles. We looked at the struggle with sin, that temptation that faces us all the time based on our own desires. Those things that innately we were born with, we want to do, whatever, that the enemy comes against us. And we talked about how to overcome in those moments. If you were not here, you need to go back and you need to watch part 1, 2, or 3. And it's not because it's us. It's the word of God. It changed our life, if you'll get this down. Today, we are in part 4. And I'm really excited because today, we are going to share a story with you about a girl who learned how to overcome. She learned how to get through her struggles. And all of us are going to face them. And what we have to decide, are you going to go through your struggles? Are you going to be an overcomer? Or are you just going to sit down and sulk and say, I'll always have this issue. I'll always be an addict. I'll always have this problem. Whatever this struggle is. Today, it's one of our own. Her name is Miss Autumn. I want you to watch and hear her story.
Hello, my name is Autumn Duckworth. I just moved here in December from Georgia to Grove, Oklahoma, and turned out to be one of the best decisions of my life. I started attending Mountain Movers Church, and God had been laying it on my heart to share my testimony for almost a year now, and I kept telling him no because I felt ill-prepared or unworthy, or I was not ready yet, or I hadn't overcome to the point that I needed in order to help people with it, But when God tells you to do something, you don't say no. Many are the plans in a man's heart, but it's the Lord's purpose that prevails. And it doesn't matter. 7 ways to Sunday, he's going to make it happen. So here goes nothing. For 11 years of my life, I struggled with a very severe eating disorder. Which, looking back, it was really just me trying to find my identity in the world and instead of in Christ. And trying to just fit the world's mold. And I remember at a very early age, when kids call you fat or ugly or chubby or thunder thighs, those things, those words cut like a knife, and they stick with you, and you start to just believe that's what you are. And I identified myself as the fat kid, and I would beat myself up mentally all the time. And as I got older, I determined that if I was just skinny, all the problems in the world would be okay. Like, things would come at you, but it was okay because you were skinny, and that's all that mattered. So I wanted to be the skinny girl for the rest of my life. And in order to make that happen, you know, well, first of all, I remember as a little kid, such a vain prayer when you look back at it, but when you're a kid, you don't realize. I would pray every day that God would just make me tall, skinny, and tan every single day. And so when I got old enough, I decided that I was going to be skinny. And so in desperation to be beautiful in the world's eyes, I starved myself. I would over-exercise. I would find myself with my finger down my throat after I'd gorged myself on a huge meal, and I just couldn't handle it. And I did get really skinny on the outside, and I got lots of compliments from the world's eyes, and but it still wasn't good enough. You know, every time I'd lose 5 pounds, I'd say, okay, well, 5 more pounds and I'll stop, or 5 more pounds and I'll stop. And then that 5 pounds would come off, and then I wouldn't stop. It just was mentally and emotionally, I was a mess. And I became very depressed and had terrible anxiety. All of the lying and hiding just weighed so heavy on my heart. And all the hurt that I was causing my family. And I just felt so empty and broken on the inside, because I wanted to be able to show my family how much I loved them, but I couldn't even spend 5 minutes with them after I'd eat a meal, because I just had anxiety. And I had to get rid of it. There was no way that I had that extra 5 minutes to spare with them. And it hurt me, but it hurt them a lot. And eventually it became that anytime I was stressed out about anything, the way I would handle it is to turn to my best friend, my eating disorder. You know, that was the only thing that told me it was okay when things went wrong, or comforted me, or the only thing that understood me, but it was also my worst enemy. It was killing me. And I knew this, but I couldn't stop it. And, you know, it was just crazy, because a one-time quick fix had just robbed 11 years of my life, looking back. And God was there the entire time. You know, I grew up in a Christian home. I knew who God was, but I just wouldn't let him be in control. It's like he was reaching out to me saying, Autumn, I'm here. I can help you. Just trust me. Like, let me determine what happens to you, or let me be in control of your body, because you're beautiful to me. And I just wouldn't let him. I was bound and determined that I was smarter than he was. And I would find myself like face down on the floor begging that he'd take it away. But the moments that I needed to just hang in there a little bit longer and just trust him, I couldn't do it, and I would just give in to my own selfish desires. And, you know, this led me to being in rehabs. I was in rehab twice for my eating disorder, and but ultimately I'd come out of it, and I would just turn back to my old patterns. As I got older, God had given me a vision that one day he was going to use my struggle to help other girls that had the same struggle that I had. But I didn't foresee that ever happening, because I was still facing it on a day in and day out basis. And there was just no way that was going to happen. But I had always had a passion for health and fitness, and I decided to pursue my passion to be a personal trainer, and I became a trainer. And during this time that I trained, to be honest with you, I was able to help a lot of people. I mean, I turned a lot of people's lives around, and they would just come to me and thank me and be like, I never thought I could do this in a million years. but I have. And I would look at that and I would feel accomplished, but then again, I'd look at myself and say, if I can help them to do that, why can't I do that? And I would get mad at God because I'm like, God, here I am changing their life, but I can't even change my own. What's wrong with me? And I would always tell myself, though, and once again, it was a control issue. I would tell myself, well, that works for them. If I tell them how to eat healthy in this way or this exercise regimen, it'll work for them, but it's not the same for me. I'm different. And I was just mentally warped. But looking back at the situation, I see how God was using me despite my struggles. And he would show me that I was a hypocrite. And if I can't dish out advice and take the advice that I'm giving, then it's worth nothing. And Satan has a way of deceiving you and keeping you from what God has planned for you. But after years of God just bending and breaking me and showing me that he's always there despite my blatant disobedience and my constant failure to overcome, he finally broke me down to nothing. And, you know, at times I've been an overcomer, and then at times I've been a complete failure. I would take 5 steps forward and 10 steps backwards. And all of this, however, has been very humbling and taught me to rely on God. And, you know, I can honestly say I don't think my relationship with God would be the same if I hadn't had this struggle, because it taught me how to cry out to him, and that there's sometimes in your life where no person can help you. Only God can. And I wouldn't trade these 11 years, even though they've been tough. They've taught me a lot. And he's shown me that we are called to love and forgive others, and that an addiction is addiction no matter what form it comes in. And he's just given me compassion for people and to understand them. And, you know, he has forgiven me more times than I deserve. He's full of love and compassion, and his mercies are renewed daily. And no matter how many times you condemn yourself, he loves you, and he's willing to turn your life around if you'll just let him be in control. And we're not called to do anything but have faith and love and trust him, faith and obedience. And I heard one time that salvation is faith plus nothing, and that's so true. If we just have faith in God and that he's going to do what he tells us he's going to do, then it can turn our lives around, you know. And he showed me that just because I have weaknesses, I'm not weak, because his power is made perfect in weakness. And we would never know how beautiful the mountains are if we never went through the valleys of life. And I still have times that I fall short and I fail. The battlefield of the mind is a constant pursuit. But each battle that I have faced has brought me closer to God. And I know that he is always there. All I have to do is be still and let him fight for me. And he never leaves us or forsakes us. One of my favorite verses is 2 Corinthians 12:9. But he said to me, "My grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in your weakness. Therefore, I will boast all the more gladly about my weaknesses, so that Christ's power may rest on me." And just as he tells us in his word, he will restore what the locusts have eaten. And I know that to be true. And it may have been 11 years, but there's so much more life to live and life to come. I can't wait to be able to use what he's given me, even if I can only help one person, from sticking their finger down their throat and thinking that's going to make life beautiful. Then it's worth everything that I've been through. Thank you.
Wow. You can give Autumn a hand. You know, Autumn's story is a perfect example of a real life struggle. And although her struggle may not be the same thing you struggle with, it was so brave of her to come forward and to say, God has been dealing with me for an entire year to share my story. And when she did, Brad and I told her, you know, the scripture says that we are overcomers by the blood of the Lamb. If it's not for Jesus, we can't overcome. And by the word of our testimony. You see, this whole time we've been talking about struggles. We're talking about testing. We're talking about trials. We're talking about being squeezed in moments of life. And here's the thing. You can't have a testimony if you never have a test. You're never going to pass a test you didn't take. You know, a lot of times in life, we think it would be easier if God never tested us, if we never had to face anything hard. But can you imagine how weak you would be and how weak I would be if we had never faced anything? This morning, we're going to look quickly at a passage in James 1, 19 through 26. And although we could do an entire series on these few verses, we're going to try to condense it this morning because this is something you need if you're going to be successful through your struggles. We're looking at James 1 and 19, and it says this. Understand this, my dear brothers and sisters. You must be quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to get angry. Human anger does not produce the righteousness God desires. So get rid of all filth and evil in your lives and humbly accept the word of God. He has planted in your hearts, for it has the power to save your souls. But don't just listen to God's word. You must do what it says. Otherwise, you are only fooling yourselves. For if you listen to the word and you don't obey it, it is like glancing in a mirror. You see yourself, you walk away, and you forget what you look like. But if you look carefully into the perfect law, that's God's word, that sets you free. And if you do what it says and you don't forget what you've heard, then God will bless you for doing it. If you claim to be religious, but don't control your tongue, you're fooling yourself and your religion is worthless.
That's good. So the word says, be quick to listen. Be quick to listen. Have you guys ever met someone who they just acted like they knew everything and they had all the answers? Now, if that's you, don't raise your hand, right? But we've met that person, right? We've met that person that just carries themselves in such a way, or maybe even they just outright say it, you know? Oh, yeah, I knew that. Yeah, yeah. And then they begin to just kind of fill in all the blanks, and they begin to tell you everything they know. And blah, 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 right? They know it all. They're know-it-all, right? Well, the Bible's telling us here, don't be like that. Don't be like that person who in your mind, in regards to God's word, don't come at it with an attitude. It's like, I know it all. I know what I'm supposed to do. I know the ins and the outs of God. I've read God's word before. I know what I'm supposed to do. Don't think that you know everything about the scriptures, because none of us know hardly anything about the scriptures. We were watching God's Not Dead. Rented that the other day for the kids. We had seen it before, but the kids were watching it again. And there's a scene, if you haven't seen it, I'm not going to blow it, but there's a scene close to the end where this man is taking his last breath. He's about to pass away. He's been struck by a car. He's laying on the ground. He's bleeding, and he is about to die. And this man is really struggling. He is struggling, right, to accept Christ. And this pastor is standing by, and he's kneeling over this man's body, and he's telling him, hey, you know, in just a few moments, you're going to know more about God than any of us here. In just a few moments. So just, he had just received Christ. He was taking his last breath. And that stood out to me because I thought, you know, even as a pastor or someone, man, you've gone through years and years of study and Bible college and all this stuff. It's great stuff. But when you pile it all up, it's nothing compared to everything there is to know about God. We know nothing, and there's so much to learn. So God's word is telling us, really, be hungry, be eager, be ready, be instant to receive what God's word has to say to us. I'll never forget, I was 15 years old. I literally thought I knew everything. I was in a heated debate with my brother. My dad was standing by. I'm like, Dad, come on. Help me out here. And my brother said, Oh man, you know what? I totally forgot. You're 15. You know it all. You know everything. And matter of fact, I wish when I was 15, I knew half as much as you know, because you're so brilliant. You know it all. You know it all. I've never forgot that, because I thought, what's that supposed to mean? I will never forget it. And as I look back, I hit like, when I hit 30, I thought, no, when I went to college, I was like, I don't know anything. Then by the time I hit 30, I'm like, Dad, I'm sorry for everything. If I ever questioned you in any way, please, I'm listening. Please teach me, because I know you've already forgotten more than I will ever know about life. Please teach me. This is what the scripture is saying. Have that kind of an attitude towards God's word. Now notice, this is really crazy. Notice in this passage that it doesn't say be quick to look. It says be quick to listen. Why wouldn't it say be quick to look? I mean, vision is one of the senses. It's powerful, right? Why wouldn't we be quick to look? Because the word listen entails hearing what God has to say for your life and for your situation. Here's the problem. I want you to follow me here, because this is very important. Too many people are, instead of listening to what God has to say to them in their lives, they're looking for what God can do. But pay attention here. There are people that they love going to church because they're seeking after the signs of God and after the things that God can do, the miracles, the miraculous, and all those things are great, right? God is a miracle-working God. He is. But Jesus, when he was talking to the Pharisees, he said that it's a wicked and perverse generation that seeks after signs. Jesus, when he was speaking to his disciples, he said, it is so easy for you to believe and follow me because I'm right here. You can see me. You're living with me. You're eating with me day in and day out. You're following me around these villages, and you're seeing me with your eyes perform all these amazing miracles. Well, of course you believe. You're seeing it with your eyes. That doesn't take faith. It doesn't take faith to see God moving mountains, right? What takes faith? We've been talking about it this whole series. It's sitting in the chair, not being able to see what God is doing or how he's moving. Faith is just knowing that you know that you know that you know in your heart of hearts that God is going to do it. And opening up your, listen, this is maturing in the faith. When you get to a place to where you're sitting in the chair and you're saying, God, I can't see you moving. But faith is saying, I'm just going to sit here and I'm going to underabide in patience and in understanding, and I'm going to choose to believe that, God, you are going to meet me here because your word says it. And I believe it. Because if your word says it, I believe it, right? And furthermore, it doesn't matter if you believe it or not, because his word says it. So it's true, right? That's what we're talking about. Don't go by what you see. Don't seek after the signs of God. Don't say, oh, God, if I could just show me a sign, Lord. Just show me a sign, God, please. Show me you're real. I got your attention, didn't I? That's cool. Each and every day, he's trying to show you a sign, but you won't. What is it? I don't know what it is. He's always trying to speak to me, but I don't know. Like, if he would have just written a book, a manual. That's a good idea. Somebody ought to do that. Write a manual for life that's like God wrote through people. That would be awesome. Right? Dude, this is like the most incredible miracle sign. If you want to see a sign, this has stood the test for thousands of years. And nobody, no atheist, right, with the most brilliant mind, has been able to disprove it. It's inerrant. It's holy. It's God-breathed. It's inspired by him, given to us for everyday life. It's a miracle. It's a miracle. And you have it in your hands. And you get to read it each and every day. Don't be a looker. Be a listener. Be quick to listen.
The next part says that we are to be slow to speak. How many of you guys have ever had a challenge with your mouth? Will you back this up? You bunch of liars.
Come on.
Me and Barb are the only people that have ever struggled with our mouth. All right. Well, then I'm talking to most of you because you just didn't want to raise your hands. Listen to me.
It's about to get
the
exciting
The Word of God
here.
Says we are to be quick to listen. And Brad just explained that. But at the same time as we are to be quick to listen, we are to be slow or tardy. How many know what the word tardy means? To be late to something, to be tardy. That's what the word slow literally means, is to be tardy in speaking, all right? To be tardy in speaking, I wish so bad that I could rewind time, and I've said this so many times to myself, and I wish I could go back to being a kid when I started getting really obnoxious, and then my teenage years, and I wish I could have got it when my parents said, Misty, think before you speak. Misty, think before you speak. I'm like, whatever, right? I just always was running my mouth. Like Brad, I knew everything until I went to college, and then I knew nothing. And to this day, I think I get dumber as time goes on, and I learn more. I'm like, I don't know anything. Who are we? But here's the thing. As we're going through those challenges, we're going through those struggles, we learn that the word endure means to under abide, right? So we're sitting here in the right positioning with God, and we are to endure, under abide during our struggles, whatever that struggle may be, all right? It's going to be different for all of us. And as we are doing that, the traits that you need to have and the traits I need to have is as we are facing those struggles, that we are quick to listen to God's word, all right? That we are quick to listen as we're praying, that we're saying, God, speak to me. Not God, I want to see a miracle, but God, speak to me. Show me what you want me to learn through this. And God, help me to keep my mouth shut. Because listen, here's what we do all the time. We pray that prayer, and then we get up to do our day, right? And we run into Joe Blow at work. How's it going? Oh my goodness. My car just broke down. My life just stinks. My kids are brats. I mean, they are little demons. They're horrible. We don't have enough money to pay the bills. My husband is so annoying. I don't even know why I married him, right? And they go on and on. And have you ever met that person? You're like, I'm sorry I ask. You know what I mean? You're like, don't ask how they're doing anymore because you're going to hear it. And what we do is we completely cross out and cancel out everything we pray. When we get up to do our day after we spend our time in our word and had our time in prayer, and we say, God, I want to underabide. God, I want to endure through my trial. God, I want to hear you speak to me. And God, help me. Lord, if I'm going to speak, to only speak the promises of God. See, you can speak, but if you'll truly think about what you should say before you actually say it, you'll realize that the Bible says that you can do all things through Christ who gives you strength. You'll realize that the word of God says, greater is he that is in me than he that is in this world. No struggle I'm going to face, I won't be able to overcome with Jesus on my side. You see, when you begin to think about what you need to say and realize that the Bible says there is power of life and death in your tongue. What do you want it to be in your life? Do you want death in your life, or do you want to live life by your tongue? By the things you say to your children. And I'll tell you right now, if I ever hear you call your kid a demon, I will put you in your place in a very nice way. Because here's why. Whatever you say with your mouth, you give them a license to be. All right? Your kid may act like a brat, but don't call them a brat or they will be a brat because you gave them a license to be it because you called them that. All right? So when you say, I can't do it, you won't do it. When you say, I'm never going to get over this addiction, you're not going to get over that addiction. I've always had this problem. I've always struggled with this. You'll always continue to struggle with it too because you continue to speak it out of your mouth. The word of God makes it so clear. Be quick to listen to what God wants to speak into your life during that struggle and be slow to speak. Think before you allow something to come out of your mouth during a struggle. Because the very thing God wants to do in your life, you can destroy it with your own mouth.
So I'm going to ask you a trick question. Do not answer out loud because you might get embarrassed. Is it a sin to be angry? Think about it. Is it a sin to be angry? The Bible says to be angry, but sin not. So then we have to rationalize within ourselves. So how can I be angry but not sin, right? How can I be angry and not sin? The Bible says that we are to be slow to get angry, right? Slow to get angry. Now, some of you are thinking, okay, but I know that story about Jesus. He went and cleared the temple. Man, he just threw those tables over and he was just cleaning house, right? He was angry. But did he sin? No, he didn't sin. He had a holy anger and he was cleaning house for the right reason. He was on a mission and he was letting everybody know what was up, right? And Paul was really good at that too. Paul, if you read some of his writings, he was always cleaning house, always telling people, hey, da, 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 and he was just going down the line, showing them the error of their ways, right? I'm not telling you go out and tell everybody the error of their ways. I'm just saying that sometimes for a lot of us, and I know you read the scripture and at face value, you think it's talking about blowing your lid, which is scriptural. Be angry, but sin not, right? What this scripture is talking about is it's talking about when you are boiling over with frustration in your life, that temptation. We talked last week about temptation, kind of just hovering over your head, right? Kind of like the same illustration of under abiding with God, but we're talking about temptation. Your frustration just causes you to get hotter and hotter and hotter and hotter until you begin to boil and then you blow up and you lose your temper, right? What this passage is talking about is allowing something to frustrate you so much, or really someone, that you not only blow up and you lose your temper, but what you do is you settle into a long-term spirit of unforgiveness. It's saying be slow to get settled into a mindset where long term you will decide not to forgive somebody because of what they've done to you and because of how they've done you wrong. Now, you'd never understand that by reading this at face value, but that's what this is talking about. Now, you think about it. When has unforgiveness in your life produced any righteousness of God? When has it produced any fruit in your life? You know what? I'm just going to completely I'm going to harbor bitterness and anger and rage towards this individual because of what they've done to me, because of what they've done to my family. What they did was wrong, and I will not forgive them for what they've done. When has that ever in any relationship produced anything fruitful? Never. You think back right now in any relationship you've ever had with a coworker, with your employer, with your children, with your spouse, right? With loved ones. Oh my goodness, I hear some of the best stories of people when they go to have Christmas dinner with all their family. All these fights break out. It's awesome. And there's all the, I'm serious, as a pastor, it's pretty cool because you get to hear all these stories of all these people like, I'm not looking forward to going home for Christmas because I cannot stand my sister. She drives me up a wall and I'm going to hear her going, nah, 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 go on and on and on. And I can't stand it, right? We can't allow ourselves to get settled in this kind of a spirit. Think about this. The Bible says that life is but a what? A vapor. It's here and then it's gone. Why did Jesus say in the prayer where his disciples come to him and they say, Lord, teach us how to pray. He says, all right, here's how you do it. Our Father who is in heaven, hallowed be your name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Right? What does he say next? Forgive us of our what? Sins, trespasses, right? And forgive those who have trespassed or sinned against us. Now, do you think the Lord wanted us to pray one day a month? One day a year? Maybe just on the Day of Atonement? Just on Easter, maybe? Or every day? God wants us to pray every day. Every single day. He says, pray without ceasing. He says, watch and pray, 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 pray. Pray, pray, pray. Every day, every day, every day. Pray, pray, pray every day. And as we're praying, we're praying this, God, for now, don't just forgive me of my sins. What are sins? It's those things that we say, those things we think, those things we do that build a thank you between us and, right? I'm not him. Whoa! It's craziness. Craziness happening here. It's not going to break. It's like made of plastic or something. I don't know what it is.
The cheaper, the better. There we go.
Right? So don't, Lord, don't just forgive me of my wall that I've built up between you and myself, because I know that you want relationship with me. But forgive those who have built a wall between them and myself and between them and God. The Bible says, bless those that curse you. That's a whole message in itself. That's so hard. But the Bible also says that we're supposed to decrease. That's us. Brandy was talking about fasting a little while ago. That's the whole point of fasting. That we disappear. I'm talking about the inside, I'm talking about your mind, your flesh, your desires disappear so that God can appear. You are decreased so that God can increase. And when that happens, you begin to think and pray differently. You begin to say, God, don't just forgive me of my sins. God, forgive those who have sinned against me. Help me, God, to be slow to get settled into a spirit of harboring unforgiveness towards others. Help me to just let it go. Because Jesus was hanging on the cross, and my sins and your sins were on his shoulders. And he was pierced in his hands, and he was looking down at the people that were mocking him, that had nailed him to that cross. And he said these words that are so powerful and so true. God, Father, please forgive them because they know not what they do. And Christ wants to fuel us with the same spirit, the same mindset, the same mentality of forgiving people for what they've done and loving them in spite, becoming more and more like Jesus.
All right, so we're looking at actions that you are to do during your struggle, all right? So we're to be quick to listen. We're to be slow to speak, slow to get angry. And the final part of that passage says this: we are to be doers of the word and not hears only. It says in verse 22, but don't just listen to God's word. You must do what it says. Otherwise, you are only fooling yourself. For if you listen to the word and you do not obey it, it is like glancing at your face in a mirror. You see yourself, you walk away, and you forget what you look like. But if you look carefully into the perfect law or the word of God that sets you free, and if you'll do what it says and don't forget what you've heard, then God will bless you for doing it. I'm going to quickly explain this to you this morning. We are to be doers of the word and not hearers only. The word doer means a continual process. It means whatever you're doing in life, you should be applying the word of God to that area of your life. It's a continual process. You're never going to arrive, but if you don't try, you're never going to get anywhere. And it says that a person who hears the word of God and doesn't do what it says is like a person who looks at themselves in a mirror, walks away, and forgets what they look like. But listen, when you study this out, it's not just a passing glance, all right? It's not just like you glanced by and you walked on by and you missed that you're like had something on your face. This is like you've been out playing in the mud. You are covered in dirt. You walk in. You examine yourself in the mirror for the longest time. See, somebody should tell me that I've got black on my face. See, you look at yourself and you begin to go, oh, I got to get that off, right? This literally means a person who hears the word of God and does not obey it is a person who stares into the word of God. They clearly see that their life does not line up. They close the word of God. They get up. And they walk away. And they say, that's good for somebody else, but it's not good for me. And he says, the person who does that is not wise, but the person who is a doer, continually applying the word of God, continually reading and applying the word of God to their life is blessed. Last week I told you what blessed means. It means to be highly favored of God in this passage. Do you want to be highly favored of God? That was a pathetic yes. I mean, I got like two. Do you want to be highly favored of God? I would say
yeah.
Yes. Do I want to walk in the blessings of Almighty God? Yes. Then God makes it so clear to us. Do what the Word of God says. He did write a manual. It is God breathing. All I have to do is every day open it up. And it doesn't matter where I open it. I can apply it to my life. When I do that, your life and my life will never be the same.
That's right. Let us not forget, the struggles make us stronger. Struggles come in many different shapes and sizes. But God allows struggles in our lives. He does not tempt us, but he allows struggles to happen. It's called life, right? It's called the enemy capitalizing on opportunities to bring temptation into our life. Nonetheless, those are struggles, and the struggle is real, but the struggles are meant to make us stronger. The question is, will you allow God to make you stronger through the struggles? Will you choose, instead of reacting and jumping up out of the chair and trying to make things happen yourself, trying to play God, will you sit in the chair and accept the fact that he is God and he can do all things with or alongside men, or doing things on your own? These things are impossible, the Bible says. But with or alongside God, all things are possible. Let us not forget the one who gives us strength. This is the one whose arm is not short. His arm is long. He knows exactly where you're at. He knows exactly what you're going through. He knew you before you were ever even in your mother's womb, right? He sends his son to invade earth. He willingly takes that death walk to the cross, dead man walking to the cross. He takes our sins upon himself, and he voluntarily allows them to nail him there, and he takes our sins with him. Now, here is the fastball in this whole story, okay? Death couldn't hold him. The grave couldn't consume him. He comes back glorified, purified. In victory, he has overcome death and the grave. And here is the best part of it all. The same power that raised him from the grave is alive inside of you. Those of you that have accepted him into your life, and we tend to forget when the struggles get real, we tend to forget that the God inside of us is so much bigger than the battle before us. And we give in to the lies of the enemy over and over and over and over and over again. We give in to the lies. Instead of just sitting in the chair and saying, God, I know that your word is true. I choose to believe that you are able to do exceedingly abundantly above and beyond what I can imagine, comprehend, ask for, dream of, think of. In Jesus' name, he can do it. Will you let him do it? That's the question. That's, in a nutshell, this entire series. Are you going to let him do it through the struggles, or aren't you? Stand up today. How many of you guys, in your sincerity of heart, would say, I will. I will choose to allow God to be my God in good times and in bad. I will sit in the chair no matter what comes my way. How many of you guys would say that? Yes? Amen. 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 Here's the reality, guys. The struggles, none of us are exempt. The struggles are going to come. Some of you have already been through the struggles and you have scars. Remember that life is a vapor and we should consider it joy when we come into these struggles, because it's God making us stronger. Who are you going to praise? Right? You've got this. You've got this. Does cancer have anything on us? No. Does sickness, does emotional hurt, right? Do our circumstances, when they completely turn and it's not what we expected, can any of it overcome us? Nothing. Nothing and no one. Because we are in a temporary state of being. And God's presence is eternal. God's presence is eternal. And that's my hope. I live with that every single day, and I want the same for you. I want to pray for you right now. Father, as the struggles come, I pray, God, that we would grow stronger because we've allowed you to be God in our lives. God, don't let us go into freak out mode. God, let us turn to you and cling to you and run to you, God, because you are able. Where does our help come from? It comes from you, God. It comes from you. God, I pray for those right now that are going through the struggle as we speak. I pray peace that surpasses all understanding in the powerful name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth. I speak peace to their situation, Father God, that you would consume them and overwhelm them, God, with your comfort and with your love that comes from your sweet Holy Spirit, God. Renew their strength. Help them to soar as high as eagles, Father God, in their confidence, knowing, God, that you are able. God, minister and give strength to those who are in need right now, Father God. And for those, God, the struggles are on their way, I pray that they will now, even now, make a predetermined decision that when the struggle comes, they will consider it joy. And they will sit in the chair and they will embrace the moment. They will say, God, you're making me better. You're making me better today than I was yesterday. God, thank you. God, thank you for the struggles. Thank you, God. Thanks for making me better. Thanks for forcing me to turn my eyes on you. Thank you, God, for making me get closer and drawing closer to you, God, through these times. Thank you, God, for putting me flat on my back so the only way I can look is up. Thank you, God. Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, Jesus.
With heads bowed and eyes closed, I'm going to give you an invitation right now for those of you who do not know Christ as your Savior.
If you've been trying to handle the struggles of life on your own, you're going to come to find that you're going to fail miserably, as we all did. Because without Jesus at the center core of your life, you can't have the joy that comes from sitting in the chair. It's impossible. If you're here this morning and you say, I want that. I want Christ at the center of my life. I want to be an overcomer. I want to be able to sit in the chair like you're talking about and have the joy of the Lord in my heart. Then this morning, I want to give you that opportunity with every head bowed, every eye closed. When I count to three, if you're here and that's you, and you're ready, you've made that decision, you are ready to surrender your life to Christ. You want a brand new life. You want to live it differently than you've ever lived it before. You want a real relationship with Jesus, not some superficial religion. We want to lead you in a very simple prayer today and bring you into that spot. If that's you, on the count of three, raise your hand. 1, 2, 3. Amen. I see your hand. Thank you, Jesus. Amen. Best decision you'll ever make in your life is surrendering to Jesus Christ. Church, pray together with me. Father God, I love you.
Father God, I love you.
And I ask that you would come into my heart.
I ask that you would come into my heart.
That you would forgive me of my sins.
That you would forgive me of my sins.
You give me a brand new life.
Give me a brand new life.
I want to live for you.
I want to live for you.
From this day forward.
From this day forward.
Forevermore.
Forevermore.
In Jesus' name I pray.
In Jesus' name I pray.
Amen. 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 Can you give them a hand this morning, those who just made that decision?
Hey, thanks so much for joining us today. If you want to be a part of something bigger than yourself, give to our ministry. We've made giving easy here at Mountain Movers Church. If you have your smartphone, just text the number 918-223-8090. Just push in the amount you want to give and push send. It's that easy. If you don't have your smartphone, not a problem. You can mail your giving just as easy to 24,000 South 660 Road, Grove, Oklahoma, 74344. Thanks for watching today. Hey, remember, we're dreaming big for you. We'll see you next week.